give a sweaty high five to somebody next to you and say, you know what? It is so good to see you and sweat here tonight with you. To the glory of God. We sweat to the glory of God. I never get tired of saying it, but if you're here tonight in this non-air-conditioned facility, God is doing something in your hearts, children of God. God is doing something for you to be here and not in your air-conditioned home. Again, if you are here for the first time, welcome to Prevail Church. You are in a historic number of months where two churches have become one. The former World Renegade Church and the church in Westridge has become one church. It has been hard, but it's been beautiful. And we are working to unite and become one to the glory of God. And so tonight, as we prepare our hearts and minds to give our tithes and offering, I want to share a little something that I read today. It's out of Matthew 16. And I couldn't help but laugh at this. So what's happening here is Jesus has already picked his 12 disciples. And so they've already witnessed a number of miracles, okay? And so they're on their way to the next mission. And do you know what the men are talking about? They're talking about food. They're like, oh man, we forgot our bread. What are we gonna do without our bread? Listen to this. It says, when they went across the lake, the disciples forgot to take bread. Jesus said, be careful, Jesus said to them, be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and Sadducees. This confused them. So they discussed this among themselves and said, well, it's because we didn't bring any bread. That's why Jesus is saying that, because we didn't bring the bread. Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked, you of little faith, why are you talking among yourselves about having no bread? Do you still not understand? Do you remember the 5 loaves for the 5,000 and how many basketfuls you gathered? Or the 7 loaves for the 4,000 and how many basketfuls you gathered? How is it you don't understand that I was not talking to you about bread? But be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Then they understood that he was not telling them to guard against the yeast used in bread, but against the teachings of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. This made me laugh so hard because this is what we do today as believers. Jesus is trying to teach us something that's on like a higher level, and we're still like, but what about our bread, Lord? But what about my rent, God? But what about my car payment, Lord? And God is like, don't you remember how I provided for you that one time? Wow. Don't you remember how I made sure you got your rent right on the nick of time? Don't you remember when you were negative $30 in your account and that money to repair your car still came through? Hallelujah. And yet God is trying to take us to another place and we're still like, but what about our bread? But what about the tortillas? And, you know, like we're still believing for the little things. And God is like, can't you remember the miracles that I've already done in your life? Do you know how many times I've showed up and showed off in your life? And you're still worrying about these little things? And so tonight, as you consider what you are going to give to God, even if it's out of your lack or out of your abundance, remember all the things that God has done in your life. Remember all the times that God has come through when you lost a job and then boom, another one was lined up right for you. Every time a door closes, God is already working ahead of you. He stands outside of time and he is opening doors for you because you are his children and he will not allow his children to beg for bread. He will provide for every one of your needs, maybe not every one of your wants. But every one of your needs will be provided in Jesus' name. So let's stand to our feet and let's get ready to do what we know. Let's just simple obedience, right? We sow and we reap. We seek the kingdom first and everything else will be added unto you. So can we stand up to our feet? It looks like some of you are still preparing. Listen, there are some envelopes on your chair. And you can put your cash in there. If you write checks, continue to write those checks. If you are tech savvy, you want to give electronically, you can hop on your browser and type easytithe.com/prevailchurch. And I pray that God blesses you. So on a count of three, let's get ready to come up and give our tithes and offerings cheerfully in Jesus' name. One, two, and three. Lord, we thank you for everything. I thank you, God, for everything that you are doing in and out of the people's lives here tonight. And I ask that you bless every giver who gave sacrificially. And Lord, for those who wanted to give, I pray that you would provide seed for the sower and that you bless them, God, that you meet every one of their needs according to your perfect timing and your perfect will. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you very much, Pastor Vanessa. Give a round of a loveful, crowded, loud cheer unto the Lord because the Spirit of God is here. Can we give God a shout of praise? That's what that is. It's a shout of praise. It's for him. Amen. Like, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. You guys ever heard that song before? I remember hearing it years ago. It's like, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And everybody's just like, yes, we say it because we're redeemed and we've got the power in us that God's given us. Amen? So I'm looking at a bunch of people here right now that if you've trusted in Jesus, let me tell you this, you are part of the family of God. You've got the power of God in you. Therefore, nothing can stop you. Nothing can be before you and hold you down. It may feel like it if you let it, but if you live in the redeemed mindset that Jesus provides, then you know that nothing can block your way. Hallelujah. Amen. That's confidence in the Spirit of God. That's confidence in the name of Jesus. Listen, some of y'all are still scared to turn off the lights at night and walk around in the dark. Hallelujah. Some of you have very real anxieties about that, and I'm not trying to diminish them, but let me tell you something very clear is that, man, oh man, anything that you think that lurks in the dark, any kukui for the Spanish people here, any boogeyman for anybody else, hallelujah. Any, I don't remember the other characters, fictitious, fable, dark, mystical, vicious characters of the night, but every demon flees, they tremble, they get nervous, they're scared, they scatter when the name of Jesus is held onto, is proclaimed and declared. So let me let you know this tonight, that this is a people, if you've trusted in Jesus and you got a relationship with him, you've got power on your side. Hallelujah. And that is something that always, no matter what's going on around me, I can cling to that, I can hold on to that and say, you know what, Jesus has given me authority. Not because I am worth it in my own strength, but because he saw me and he said that I was worth it. Amen? Yeah. That's the awesome grace of God. Praise God. He's so good. So I'm excited to be here tonight because it's the time of the week where we gather as a church and we worship. And we worship in three different areas, from giving God glory with our lips, from hearing God because faith comes from that, and from giving unto God. And then even a fourth one, is which is loving each other. That's worship unto God. Amen. Like when you obey him in that, when you love God and love people, let me tell you this, you've got something just ready to be at the brink of just pouring out in your life, because what you sow is what you reap, not only monetarily with finances, but what you do unto people, you will reap. The world calls it karma. Hallelujah. Yeah. But God calls it sowing and reaping in his word. Amen. And so, if you don't know who I am, by the way, if you're here for the very first time, I don't want to put you out there, but can you put your hands in the air just a little bit, just kind of like real? If you're here for the very first time, can we just kind of say, there you go. There's how many? One? We got one person here for the very first time. No one else? Praise God. We got one dude in here. What's up, man? How you doing? Welcome to the bombest place in the world. Amen. We're glad to have you. And listen, we at the end of the day, you know what the Bible says? And I don't mean to single them out, but guess what? You know what the Bible says? That when one comes to the Lord, listen, just one person, like if one person just says straight up, like, man, Jesus is the man, I trust in him, man, I know that without him, I can't accomplish. The Bible says that there's a party, there's a celebration, angels rejoice in heaven. Now, when one person comes to, isn't that awesome? That means God cares about the one, hallelujah. It's not just the everybody, he does care about each one individually, but you know what's awesome is that everything stops in heaven and there's a party when one person comes to the Lord, amen? Amen, that's awesome, that's powerful, that's the God we serve who cares about the one, amen? So, if you haven't been here for a while, in fact, let me go another step further. Who has been here for less than 4 months? If you've been here for less than 4 months, can you put your hand in the air just real quick? For less than 4 months. Can you guys look around and see who's been? One, two, how many else? Can you guys keep your hands up? I just want to know. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Hallelujah. Yeah. Eight people. Can we just give God glory for that? Amen. That's eight people who were not here 5 months ago. Amen? That's awesome. And you guys are witnessing, as my wife mentioned earlier, Pastor Vanessa, you're witnessing history in the making. And you're able to see it from another angle. And that's a blessing. That's a blessing. How many have been here for more than, and let me say, oh, this is the thing. This is like a trick question. How many have been part of Prevail Church for the past 4 weeks? Raise your hand in the air because that's how old we are. Hallelujah. There's no such thing anymore. It's like, how long have you been a part of this church? Well, which one? Hallelujah. Prevail Church just started 4 weeks ago. Amen. So we're all like new. This is like we've been here. We've seen the place. But like it's almost like you get a house and it's renovated. And you feel like, oh, I'm in a new place right now. You know, I was in this kitchen like last week and it was roaches and rats. But it's been renovated and cleaned. That's not a true story. Praise God. But for some of you, God bless you. Some of you have able to been feeling the renovation feels. And some of you, God's going to renovate for you in Jesus' name with your faith. And of course, with the church coming together, just let your needs be known. You never know what happens. Hallelujah. Because I believe so strongly in the church obviously operating together, but seeing miracles, signs, and wonders. And you know what's awesome? I want to share something with you very briefly. Someone in this room literally came back from the doctors who said that she was about to have diabetes. All the tests were ran, literally, for months. Diabetes is there. She had diabetes. Hallelujah. But guess what? The key word is had. She's been healed. She just went. Was it yesterday? It was Saturday. She went and they said, you have no diabetes in your system. And this is the thing. We've prayed for it. Yes. We've believed God for it. Yes, she has. But there was something unique under the presence of God and what God's doing here. And something caused her to just declare against that sickness that was in her. And she just declared it. Now in Jesus' name, be free of me. Be loosed of me. She said it. She declared it. And God was faithful in that instance, and she's been healed of diabetes. Can we give God some glory for that? And I want to go on to say this, that there's no such thing as being left behind. If you're here in this place and you're going through something, don't even let the seed of the enemy sow some seed and you say, well, what about my healing, Lord? Are you hearing me? That's already the wrong heart. That's already like you want to live in that sickness. Hello. But when you give God the glory, when you rejoice when someone else is rejoicing, let me tell you guys again, sowing and reaping, God is going to bless your world. Amen. And God is so good. I just wanted to share that because I get pumped up when I hear God things happening with God people. In other words, when stuff that's in here, healings and what, yes. Hey, that's the real stuff. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. So for the past 4 weeks, we've been going on in a series, a topical series, which is very on the merge of informative and preachy and encouraging and also vision casting. It's a buffet, hallelujah, covering many grounds because there are different people here at different times. New people, people who've been around for a while, women, men, there's just different kinds. And so we're trying to be faithful in touching every area. And so right here, tonight, we are going to follow this series, Reset. Can someone say Reset? Reset. Reset has been an amazing time of really going through different moments that we have strategically prayed about, leadership-wise, and also team-wise, family-wise, friend-wise, merge-wise. And we have covered topics such as resetting our hearts. In other words, resetting our hearts. The things in our heart that we've held against people, resentment, or whatever it may be in the past. How many remember that preaching? It was about 2 weeks ago. Pastor Vanessa preached on resetting our hearts. Then there was the introduction, which is a week before that. Then we talked about leadership and how the structure looks here and moving forward, what it's going to look like. And then lastly, last week we talked about team. Can someone say team? Teamwork. And you guys got to hear a little bit also, as much as I could have shared in that moment of time, our history and knowing more about what we've been through, myself, my wife, and then, of course, those who God brought to us and we discipled over the past 5 years and under. Hallelujah. And so to some of you, this may be something you understand. When you hear vision or when you hear somebody casting vision, you're like, okay, cool, I got it. Amen. That's good, right? For others, it may be a brand new thing, right? And for others, it may be something that you are familiar with, but not fully, you're fully not on board because you're still waiting how things will progress. And I understand all that. And so this series is dedicated, again, to cast vision, encourage, literally light you if you're ready to be lit, hallelujah, and be the disciple of Jesus that God's called you to be. And with that being said, each and every one of us, I believe without a shadow of a doubt, have a destiny. Have a destiny. Can someone look to your neighbor, and if their name is Destiny, great. But look to your neighbor and say, destiny. Destiny. Hallelujah. Destiny. Every one of us in here, if we're in Christ Jesus, and even before you even know Christ Jesus, if God's called you, he already has your destiny. And many people spend their lives trying to look for what they're good at. They try stuff and then they fail. There's a song, I think, on Zootopia it is. Is it Zootopia where it's like try everything? Is that the one? Okay. It's like try everything, which sounds good, but also can be applied in negative ways as well. You don't want to try everything, all right? You don't want to jump off of a cliff because it looks fun and your harness is off. Anyway, that's another story. However, people spend their lives trying things. Am I good at this, right? People have tried to maybe go to school, and they paid a lot of money, God bless you, to get a degree, and things didn't work out the way that you expected them to work out, and that's, my heart goes out to you. But many of us have tried and tried, but we're just still trying to figure out what is it that God has for us. And I would go on to say that everyone in here, as we look at this passage in Scripture tonight, we're going to realize that God has a destiny for your life, and it doesn't just involve you, and it can't just involve you. Because if it's God's destiny for you, he's got a full circle plan for your life that will impact those that are around you and those that you have yet to come in contact with. And so tonight, before I get into the fifth week, I believe, of this series, I want to pray together because I want the Lord to honestly let his text mark our hearts tonight. And what I mean by text, guys, is the Word of God in front of me, the Bible. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness, your kindness, your favor. We thank you for your love toward us. We thank you that when we were still sinners, you found us. And we thank you that if we don't know you tonight, you're going to show yourself to us. And Lord, that we would leave here differently than we came. We give you our hearts, God. Speak to us. And we pray that our filter would be, God, one of worship. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Church, we play as a team when we play for the same goal. The same goal. And last week I mentioned a bit of that goal. I mentioned a bit of working together with purpose and humility. And in that, our identity individually, our destinies start unfolding. And I want to read Matthew 3, chapter 3, verse 1. And I want to start there at Matthew 3, verse 1. The scripture will be on the screen. Amen. Are we ready? Is it up there? Praise God. Let's read it. We're going to read about an interesting leader, an interesting character, an interesting brother in the scripture. Let's read about him. In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah. Let me pause there quickly. John the Baptist, his birth was foretold. That's what this means. It was foretold by a prophet in very big detail. And it was foretold not only connected to Jesus, as we're going to find out, but it was also a miracle that John was born. John was born to parents who were very, very elder in age. They were older folks, and he was born to them, and it was a miracle. So John was a miracle baby, and he was prophesied before he was born. And then this is what the prophet Isaiah said: the voice of one crying in the wilderness, crying, like yelling out, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Verse 4, now this John that was prophesied, he wore a garment of camel's hair, and a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Verse 5, then Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region about the Jordan were going out to him. John was popular, and he also ate bugs, and he was also dressed in hair. And they were baptized by John in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. So John the Baptist, we almost go so far into history, always bring it, and even in the past and in the future, John the Baptist, as the Baptist was his middle and last name, John the Baptist. He was interesting, to say the least. Verse 7, but when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees, now these were the religious leaders of the time, okay, for those of you, I want to spin it up, the Pharisees and the Sadducees are the high priests, religious, they're the guys that came in the robes and the jewels, and they walked up and they rolled up on John. They came deep and they came face to face with this guy in camel hair with probably locust hair, locust feet in his beard, hallelujah, honey on the bottom, because you know when you got a, he's not shaving, hallelujah. So those of you who've ever had a long beard, food is always on there. If you don't groom it, you don't. So this man looked disheveled. So imagine the religious leaders of the time are walking toward him, and they're coming deep, and they're rolling up, and they say, or rather they don't say a thing. He looks at them, and he says, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not presume to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father, for I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children from Abraham. Even now, the axe is laid to the root of the trees. He's like prophesying right then and there. He's getting real deep with these guys. And he's talking essentially about what would come and how we, the Gentiles, can be grafted in. Whereas these people would be opposed to even imagine the future where black, Puerto Rican, Caucasian, American, whatever it may be, would come to Jesus, would come to God, right? That was something they were upset with. So they were the guys who thought high of themselves. And look what happens. He prophesies to them. He goes at them. He comes directly at them. And he says, every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. He's telling these guys, he's bold. He's out there with nothing to lose. This is John the Baptist. in camera. You already know he has nothing to lose. Hallelujah. And again, I want to give you some bullet points on John a little bit more after this, but I want to read this first. Verse 11, he says this, I baptize you with water for repentance, but one is coming. He who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I'm not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn. Look at the words he's using. But the chaff he will burn will with unquenchable fire. He will burn the chaff with unquenchable fire. Now, Jesus comes to the scene, to John the Baptist, and he says, and it says, then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to John to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, I need to be baptized by you. And do you come to me? You see John's attitude toward Jesus? He says, I'm the one that needs to be baptized by you. Like, I know who you are. You're the guy. You're the one. But Jesus answered John and he says, let it be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he consented. So John heard Jesus and he said, got it. And when Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were open to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove. It wasn't a dove, like a dove, and coming to rest on him. So something really supernatural happened when Jesus was baptized by this faithful, camel hair wearing, locust eating, honey drip beard man, John the Baptist. And look what the voice came from the heavens and said. It said, this is my beloved son with whom I am well pleased. Now, John the this is what's crazy about John the Baptist. Is John the Baptist, as we read in other eyewitness testimonies in the Gospels, we see that John is actually the cousin of Jesus. Can someone say cuzzo? Hallelujah. Cuzzo. He was the cousin of Jesus. That's, yes, he was. And he was prophesied before he was born. And there was a point where Mary and the mother of John met, and then there was a leaping in their wombs at that moment. There was like some like knowing that, yes, something's going to happen between us in the future, years from now. So that's crazy in and of itself, is that even as being in the womb, it goes to show you that God does know what goes on in the womb. He is there. He knows. He knows you before it. And that is powerful in and of itself, because your mama and your daddy know you when you come out. Right? They don't know you before. They can talk about you, talk to you, sing little songs, but they don't see you yet. God already been known you. That's how intricately involved he is. And so John the Baptist was prophesied to prepare the way for Jesus. Can someone say, prepare the way? And at this time, he would essentially, not even knowingly or desiring it, multitudes of people were gathering toward John, even though he didn't want them there. He didn't call for them. They just heard what he said, and they saw him, and they followed him. So much so that you would almost believe he was a recluse in the wilderness, because that was prophesied that he would be in the wilderness. In other words, he's not in the town squares telling everybody, preaching there, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, there's going to be one greater. He's not doing that. He's out there in a strange place. He's there in the wilderness. And look what this says. John was so strange that people said that he had a demon. Matthew 11:18 says, John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he has a demon. So this is the thing. When Jesus was talking about John here in Matthew 11:18, people would think it strange that he was not at any social gathering. In other words, where people were drinking, he was not there. In fact, the Bible says that John was under a priestly covering because of his parents, and that no alcohol, this was an order to him and to his parents, that no alcohol should touch his lips. Very interesting. The Nazarites had that very unique, the priesthood had that very unique calling to stay sober in every area. So people thought it was strange that he was sober. Another thing is they said he had a demon, because the people that had demons dressed like him. They had bugs all over their beards. They had slobber. They were out by themselves. And so people literally called him a demon. And you know, to take away from that, I almost feel like when you're responsible with God's call in your life, people will come against you. When you're responsible with God's call in your life, people may not understand it, and they'll come against you. And for him, I couldn't even imagine being called a demon-possessed person. We have stories even, my wife has stories where people accused her at one point of something very bizarre and strange. And she was just a new believer trying to love Jesus. And people had a meeting about her, said she has the spirit of this and Jezebel. One of them was the girlfriend I was dating at the time. Hallelujah. Isn't that funny? That's another story. We're going to have to come back to that. That's like next season, okay? Next season. Next season, the story begins. Okay. Don't miss that. So, I could see how startling, how strange that would be, but John was faithful. He didn't pay mind to it. He did what he was called to do. John lived out his destiny. He didn't seek out the multitudes, but he attracted them. And that's very unique as well. He lived out his destiny, and the thing about John is his destiny was God's vision. His destiny was God's vision. God called him before he was born to accomplish something great. And his great thing that he was going to accomplish was, in essence, serving Jesus. His destiny that was so great that it was foretold before he was born was to serve Jesus. Serve the vision that God has given to him, which was to prepare the way for the coming of Jesus the Messiah. Now, I want you to understand this, that John, in and of himself, he had people around him saying he was the main guy. John the Baptist, people were coming around him and saying, yo, you're the Christ. You're the Messiah. What are you talking about? Somebody else is going to come. You're the one. We know you're called. Like, we could sense it. We know you're the one. But John, even in his encounter with his cousin, he didn't just have this familial vibe where he was just like, hey, what's up, man? How you doing? He looked at him. He said, I'm not even worthy to do this. I'm not even worthy to hold your dirty sandals. See, do you see how high he place the vision of this coming Messiah? This John the Baptist was faithful to the end. The way he died was he was beheaded in a very tragic, unfortunate, almost unnecessary thing, in an unnecessary way. But John died after his calling was fulfilled. His destiny was to prepare the way for the coming Jesus, Messiah, the one who would take the sins of the world and place them on himself. Your sins, my sins, he placed them on himself. He became you. He paid your fine, paid your penalty. In other words, we're born in disobedience against God. So why expect that God's going to love you? Hello. We always hear God loves everyone. Yes, however, he purchased people and redeemed them for his glory. And many people in the world look at God and say, God is this way. When all throughout the scriptures we see that God calls people, he elects people, and he chooses people. And I say this for this reason alone, that it is a miracle that God in his holiness would choose anyone like us to bring into his family when we're born against him. God is faithful and rich in mercy. Many of us are used to, even inclined, even as Christians, we have the tendency of going to a person before we go to God. Going to social media before we go to God. But God paid for your fine. God paid for it. And John the Baptist would preach about this Jesus who saved us and allowed us to be living in this time under the word of God, worshiping the Lord, knowing about him, hearing, and by God's grace, doing what we hear. So John the Baptist had a destiny. Can someone say destiny? It was to fulfill God's vision for his life. And Jesus knew he wasn't the man, but he came to prepare the way for the man. This story of John the Baptist is so key to team and teamwork, because in a team, you hear the saying all the time, there's no I in team, right? And then other people that come against that say, well, there's a me in team. Because each me's make the team, hallelujah. We do. I'm a me, you're a me, we all make the team, hallelujah. But what's interesting about this story of John the Baptist is you would think that somebody prophesied before he was born to prepare the way for Jesus was probably going to go out in a mega ministry. Hallelujah. Are you hearing me? That John the Baptist, well, he deserved, man, he needed to be in front of thousands of people, man, preaching. He needed to get some replacement garbs. Why is this man of God in camel hair and locust? He deserves something greater. Right? But John the Baptist was so faithful to the vision that he said, I am here in the wilderness and I will wait and I will be here until Jesus comes because that's my assignment. I'm here to serve and that's all there is to it. I am owed nothing but to commit myself to the plan that God has for me. We all have destinies, and these destinies are truly involving more than yourselves. See, John the Baptist's destiny, again, wasn't to just be a mogul or be a turn into a real Jesus type, dressed in basically a reverse or bizarro world Pharisee. He wasn't meant to be that of his time. He was meant to prepare the way for Jesus, and that was all. But John the Baptist died in a horrible way. He was committed to the vision God gave him. And that vision involved preparing the way. I say that again because I want to make this clear. He was serving Jesus by serving people. He wasn't just speaking by himself. There were people there listening, so much so that they said he was the Messiah. He was faithful in what God has called him to do. He was faithful in serving. This is a grand call that somebody would have before they were born, to be the cousin of Jesus, and then to die the way he did. He was unconventionally leading people without desiring it. And look what Jesus himself says of this John the Baptist. He says, among them, in other words, among humanity, that are born of women, there has not arisen a greater than John the Baptist. Jesus lifted up the humble. As the Bible says, God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. John was humble. You already know how he lived, how he died. You can read the Gospels and hear more about it. It goes at length and it shares the details. However, John the Baptist was faithful to serving people. And by serving people and preparing the way for Jesus to be worshipped, to be known, guess what happened? Jesus himself says, this guy, this is the one. There's nobody greater than that John the Baptist. He was committed, he served people, and he served me. That's what his main prerogative was. And so church, ladies and gentlemen, our greatest destiny and our greatest call, why would we even assume that we deserve something greater than John the Baptist. Again, many of us strive for great, great things, and there's nothing wrong with that whatsoever. However, so many of us strive for great things until we die and don't fully accomplish the will of God in our lives. You can keep searching, keep working towards something, but if it's not God's destiny, you will never feel fulfilled. Never. There are people that I know who've even worked in ministry in a certain specific way, and that wasn't even what they were called to do. They've had to be adjusted by God Himself. And in my life, I've realized this personally. I've had great like ideas and great desire for businesses. I do run a business. However, I've always wanted to open up like storefronts, just for cool stuff like ministry related. Have a stage there. Have whatever it's coffee, food, whatever it is. Have my own clothing brand. Have my own. Collectible store. Like, it's just so cool. Like, growing up, you just see stores and you're like, man, I'm gonna own my own store one day. That's how we all sounded as children. Come on. How many of you ever wanted to own a store at all? Like, own a store or a franchise or a Taco Bell or own a something? Come on, raise your hand if that's you. Quite a few. Some of you have not aspired to that, and that's fine. However, I've always wanted that. And so God started bringing people around me who owned their own businesses of stuff that I wanted to do. And I was like, this is cool, but it's like, but Lord, why not me? Why not me? Not in a bad way, but in more of a sad way. You know what I'm saying? More in a like, man, oh, this is cool, man. But after a few moments, literally a few moments after thinking, why not me? I really felt this really strong sense of, you know what? You wanted to do this, and now you're involved with somebody who's doing it. But you're and all of a sudden, I felt overwhelmed to be like, you know what? I'm here to serve what they're doing. Like, that's why I wanted to do it, but they're already doing it. Like, why reinvent the wheel? All of a sudden now, I find myself just helping and supporting my friends' businesses by getting them money and me getting nothing from it, because I find this joy in, man, that's their business. Man, they're doing something that I love, but they're doing it already. They got the stuff. They got their store. I'm here to help them, you know? And in that, guys, it's really crazy. I'm not lying to you. I feel the most fulfilled in literally serving just somebody else's thing, where my face doesn't have to be there. I don't have to have a, you know, CEO title in their store or their clothing brand online, say one of the founders. I don't need that. I just need to know that I'm being a help to them and supporting what they're doing. And I'm telling you guys, I feel, and this is personally, I feel super joyous to know that I can get somebody else money by just helping them out. And of course, don't get me wrong, nobody's taking advantage of me or anything like that, but I sign up for it because I'm excited about what they're doing. And so I support it, and I do what I can to support it. And what's crazy is even recently, through years of just supporting somebody, and just one of my friends, just supporting him and whatever he needs, hey, you need this logo, you need this, I'll do it. He calls me years later, and he says, hey, I want you to run the whole marketing thing. We want to pay you every month for running the whole marketing of the clothing brand. And I'm like, oh, snap. Wasn't expecting it. Didn't want it. All I was content with doing was serving his brand, serving his vision. Are you hearing me? This is a real life story. This is not a made up story. This is real life. Ask my wife. Look in my post. Ask my friends. Hallelujah. This is real life stuff. And I'm excited about it. And when I see John the Baptist in the scripture, I see the same thing, where he was content with serving what God had given him to do. And that was essentially service. We're called to serve. And many of you have heard that before. Many of you kind of get that. I understand. But when we come into a heart's position where we don't just think it and know it and do it a little, and we actually live it and feel it and show it, this is the big difference. We start seeing God opening doors for us. We start seeing God's favor upon us. We start seeing the destiny that God has for us start opening up by what? Serving the vision of what God has for you. And all of us here tonight are called with a destiny individually. And as a church, we are also called with a vision. We're called with a destiny together. And it involves people, not only us next to us, seated by us, those who have yet to come. Those who have yet to come. There are about 8 people here, maybe 1 or 2 missing, that have been here for under 5 months. So that 8 times 80, that's a very real thing that happens when a people come together as a team playing for the same goal. This is the whole motivation. I am here to serve. I'm here to serve. Because it was when that happened in my life where there was no sense of this sad feeling of like, man, but I wanted to do my own clothing brand. You know, hey, I wanted to open up my own store. That all of a sudden left, and I'm like, and then guess what happened? Like I told you, my friend called me and said, hey, I've got this for you, man. Here you go. And I wasn't expecting this, but let me let you guys know a little bit more into my life. It's a blessing to receive what we're going to receive. And again, it's not like a great, like $3,000 a month. But hey, maybe it can be one day. Amen. But how did that all happen? Serving the vision of his brand. Do you hear me? Serving the vision of his brand. That would have never happened if I was just still trying to, honey, let's save some money. Let me get my t-shirts going. I'm going to go ahead and, because it would have, for right now, it seems like a little impossible to do that. I'm just being honest with you. Hallelujah. And so John the Baptist reminds me of that in my own personal life. And I know many of you probably have instances of that in your life where you've probably had to fold and say, you know what? I'm here to help. But you had a different mindset at first. Are you hearing me? And I say this because the overarching call on your life involves salvation happening as a result of your life. Like, that's an amazing thing. There's no more fulfilled than I can get, even pales in comparison to what I said about helping people and serving. There's no more greater fulfillment that I can receive than knowing that God's used me to impact somebody's soul's destination. That is our destiny. And when we're not doing that, when we're not living that way, we're just living, we're just existing, but we don't have the Spirit of God actively motivated, just literally rolling on like a tire going forward, just continually. Are you hearing me? It's like a boost of, for those of you who've been feeling down in your Christianity, you're feeling down in your faith, you're feeling a little idle and dry, chances are you didn't open your mouth with the gospel to anybody in the past year, 6 months, 5 months. Are you hearing me? But I promise you, the moment you share the love of God that you have inside of you with somebody else, all of a sudden, you're pumped. You could go to sleep so good. You'll go to sleep better than when you get a check. Are you hearing me? Better than when an unexpected money comes at your door, or better than when you see $20 flying at your feet and you go like this and you hold it down to grab it. Hallelujah. You feel better. It's not about feeling, but it's about knowing that I have been faithful in serving Jesus. And when you get that, then all of a sudden, you are fulfilled and you're living out your destiny. Yeah. And all of a sudden, the dreams you have, the desires you have start happening.
That's good.
Do you hear what I'm saying? You're faithful what God called you to do. All of a sudden, you see God opening doors in different areas where you're like, oh my gosh, I didn't even expect this to happen. But you just had to take that extra step to serve God in this unique way and in the specific way of reaching people and loving people and preparing the way for Jesus and serving people. Then, all of a sudden, God blesses you with this. God blesses you with that. I can't even begin to tell you guys how crazy I've been blessed in my life. Little desires that I've had, foolish things like shoes, a certain thing. All of a sudden, I go somewhere, and they give me the exact same pair of shoes that I wanted. This is crazy. I went to another place, and I'm telling you this not because my desire is that it happens for everybody. Hallelujah. But there's not like a ABC book I can give you on like how to get blessed right now with these steps. That's not the case. What I can say is what God's word says. What I can say is what God's word says. If you're faithful in a little, he'll give you more. That's the principle. That's what we see in the scripture. He did it to Joseph. He enlarged territories of people who didn't have nothing, and God blessed them. But why? Because they were faithful in serving the vision of God. And that vision involves people, and that vision involves serving. And us as a church, we prevail over the gates of hell when we follow in the steps of the Master. We prevail over the gates of hell. Are y'all getting this tonight? I'm excited to see God pour out blessings in your life, and all of a sudden things start happening that you've been praying for years, but all you had to do was just serve God's vision in your life. Just serve. Not expect this, that, and the other. Again, like John could have expected everything. Like, he could have. I've been prophesied before I was born. I am the cousin of Jesus. Hello, that's a bragging. That's a real brag. Like, that's for real. Like, if I was Jesus' cousin, you tell your friends. Wouldn't you tell your friends? I would tell my friends, like, hey, oh, yeah, that's cool. You got that new lunchbox? Well, Jesus is my cousin.
You lying, man.
No, for real. I'm grown. I'm true. But he didn't do that. He was faithful with what he was called to do in serving. Are you hearing me, church, tonight? Can we stand up to our feet? Hallelujah. Lord, help us, God, be a church, God, that is indebted to your vision for us, indebted, Lord God, to serving people and being the Christians you've called us to be, being the disciples, the followers of you, preparing the way of Jesus. Church, if you could look up here for a moment. We're going to pray in a moment, but you know what's awesome about John the Baptist and us is that we also are to prepare the way, not for the coming of Jesus the first time, but for the second time. You know, the Bible says that Jesus is coming back, and you know how many churches have heard the same thing over and over again about that for years, so much so that people had false flag, they had the candles ready, and they had their stuff all packed up and ready to go. And they're like, Jesus is coming. It's May, what is it, 20? What one was it? 2007? Or there were some people just ready, you know. There were, and also in the before the 70s, there were so many. However, it's like the boy who cried wolf, right? You think of it that way. The world does, at least. Oh, they've been saying Jesus is coming back for decades. But church, we are here to prepare the way for the coming Jesus. And that is preaching the good news that Jesus is the only way to not only heaven, but to bring heaven on earth, to free you from the chains of death and hell, to free you from your own thoughts that will lead you astray, to free you from the sin that has you in bondage. This is the message of the gospel, that Jesus has come so that you may be set free. Not chasing the wind and beating the wind and saying, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. Maybe I should go to school. Maybe I should work here. Maybe I should try this in ministry. Maybe I should go to this church. Maybe I should do this. Maybe I should leave. Whatever it is. His call on your life, his ultimate fulfillment comes by your faith in him. And this is the beginning of our lives when we trust in him. There's no other place that I'd rather be than to know that Jesus gave everything for me, and without him, I have nothing. The Apostle Paul said it himself in the Word of God. He said, I presume to know nothing but Christ and him crucified. In other words, he counts everything as dung, as trash, everything. People, even in that regard, when you compare it to the goodness of God, not dismissing that, but knowing that everything else in this world that would try to take you back or try to work on you or try to take your time, all of it is nothing in comparison to knowing Christ Jesus, because he found something out that many of us need to find out, and many of you are finding out as your life goes on, is that ain't no one gonna do you like Jesus. Ain't nothing in this world can give you the hope, the fulfillment, the direction, the clarity, the peace. It's not a religious thing that you just have in a moment's time. It's not just the cliche Christian, it's a relationship thing. No, it's a lifetime thing. It's a soul thing. It's an everything. So if you're here tonight and you know Jesus, can you just pray with me tonight that we would serve like we know Jesus, that we would love like we know Jesus, that we would build together like we know Jesus, that we would trust and serve like we know Jesus. If that's you, can you pray that? And if you're here and you don't know Jesus like that, you just don't know, you've been coming to church for a while, but that's about it. Maybe you've never heard the voice of God in His word or in any way. I want to challenge you tonight, and I want to encourage you that God has your destiny in His hands. But there is a step of faith that is required that only God could bring about. And this is the environment for that to happen. It's where people of faith gather together under the banner of Jesus, under the vision of the house. And if you're here tonight, you don't know Jesus like that. You just know about Him. You've seen Him in pictures. You assume that's Him. Let me tell you this. Jesus holds everything together. And apart from Him, we die in our sins. In other words, the things you were born with, the things that you were born in, those things that you came in with were a result of sin, disobedience in the garden. The first book of the Bible, you can read it just a few chapters in, that there was disobedience. And then all of a sudden, what was once perfect was mutilated into something that was so disparaging. It is what sin is now. It's what disease is. God didn't put diabetes in people. God didn't put sicknesses in people. However, a result of sin is that we are in a fallen world. But let me tell you this. In a fallen world, there is a God who can lift you up and change and transform you from the inside out, so that once you were blind and now you see. The Bible says that the carnal man cannot understand the things of the Spirit. I want your eyes to be open to the Spirit. So if you're here tonight, you don't know Jesus like that, can you just pray to Jesus and just say, forgive me for my sins. I trust in you tonight. Fill me with your Spirit and lead me. Just pray that simple thing. And then also pray in your own words. Pray your own words. Jesus, forgive me for my sins. I have faith in you. I trust in you. I hear what this preacher's saying. I believe that you died for me, that you were buried with my sins, and that you rose on the third day. If that's you, just talk to Jesus right now. Lord Jesus, you rose on the third day for me, that by your resurrection, I can be a new creation. I can know you. I can feel you. I can hear you. I can see you. I can find you. And if you're here and you say this is your church, let us pray this together if we can do that. Can we just pray a very unified prayer? Can you repeat after me with this? Say, Lord Jesus, I want to be like you. I want to love like you. I want to talk like you. Help me be the disciple that is faithful in what you've given me. Lord, I trust in you that godliness with contentment is great gain. Pour into us, Lord, so that we can accomplish great exploits in your name as a body. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, the power of God is here tonight. We just declared something. Some of you guys just declared something, and you said it. And once you said it, you said it. Hallelujah. Let God be the one to follow through in your life, and you be the one to stay committed to His vision, what He's doing, and how great He is, how perfect He is. Amen. Amen. Can we give God some glory in here by our hands, by our amens, by a shout of praise? Amen. On forward, we will prevail because you were made to prevail. Amen. Can you take your seats just for a moment as we end tonight? It is 8:33, and we are so perfectly on time as we usually always are. Hallelujah. But when God does something grand and there's altar calls, in other words, where people come up and there's prayer, of course, that's going to take longer. But guess what? Let God be God and every other man be a lie. Amen? Hallelujah. And so before we leave church, first of all, I want to just excuse Pastor Rich Cho, who is not here because he just had his latest son. Hallelujah. His latest son just came out. Amen. One day we'll have the same privilege, my wife and I, to say that. For those of you guessing and wondering, hey, what about, you have kids? We don't have kids yet, but pray for us that a miracle can happen. Amen? We ain't holding nothing back, just so you know. Feels up to me. Hallelujah. Courtney, you know, we would just be, they'll be right here. All of them. 40 of them. Children!
Dad!
But pray for us. Amen? I'm super excited for my wife, what she's been doing throughout the past few weeks, meeting with some of you, and God's really just really using her mightily here in this church, and I'm thankful for Pastor Vanessa. But Pastor Rich has been out, and the reason being is because his son, and we wanted to bless him. He was on his way back. We said, Pastor Rich, you just had a kid. God bless you. We good. He knows. I just told him, Pastor Rich, man, go bless your family a little bit. Don't worry about it right now. Amen. Hallelujah. Isn't that awesome? He'll be back next week. And for those of you who don't know who Pastor Rich is also another leader here. He's an amazing man of God. Him and his wife and his children, his eight children. Hallelujah. Praise God. I tell him, I say, I want to be on your level, you know. Give me that anointing. Maybe it's your hands that need to be on me when you're praying. I don't know what it is. Just kidding, guys. It's all the Holy Spirit. But I wanted to just briefly announce this, and that is for those of you who desire to be connected with what's going on, you can totally be a part of our Facebook group. We have a Prevail Church Facebook group online. That's Prevail Church on Facebook. And if you don't have a Facebook, but you have a computer, just make a Facebook account. Let me tell you why. My grandma has one. Hallelujah. I know other ladies who are in their 80s. Hallelujah. Who have a Facebook account as well. God bless them. However, we want to stay connected in some way, shape, or form. So if you're able to do that and you'd love to be a part of what goes on online, listening, hearing, seeing, kind of conversing, we have a private Facebook group. It's private because we're still unlaunched. So for those of you who are still questioning or kind of figuring out, what do you mean? We're meeting as a church, but why are we saying 2018? The reason being is because we want to refine and reset a lot of things to honor God and give God glory and do things in a way that would bring about honor, excellence, and come on, just a few of y'all got it. Hallelujah. So when everybody gets it, that's when I know we're going to stop the series. Amen. Hallelujah. So we want to give God come on, we're getting close. Hallelujah. Honor, excellence, and commitment. And that is; those are all three multifaceted things. And so we want to give God that. My wife does have an amazing announcement, very awesome announcement, regarding the ladies in the house. The ladies, hallelujah. Come
where
on,
the ladies at?
Come on, where are the ladies at tonight? Come
That's
on.
That's right. Okay, so I've been making rounds to all of the women's groups that have been meeting on Wednesdays, on Tuesdays, and I really just wanted to commend all of the women that belong to World Renegade and that had belonged to the church in Westridge, because it's been difficult to do something that's very unfamiliar. Okay, how many know that when you start meeting with a group of ladies and you form bonds, they become family? And part of the vision of the women that God has given me, and really of the church, is that we need to unite. And so I've been meeting with all of the ladies. I still have one more meeting next week, another meeting. But what we've been doing is that we've agreed that for a season, we are all going to come together and we're going to try our best to start meeting on Friday nights, just for a season. This is going to give me the opportunity for God to start showing me who he has in mind to start having their own groups, to start leading. And it's gonna give me the opportunity to equip, to disciple, and it's gonna give us the opportunity to get to know one another a lot better. How many know that God has given women influence? He has. And if all the women can unite, I truly believe this city, this community is going to be rocked. Because
Hallelujah.
When women unite, when we, it's like everything else falls into place. I mean, how many know when dad is upset at home, you'll feel a little bit. But if mom is upset at home, good luck. Okay? That's just how it is, because mom has a particular influence. Women have an influence. And so I know that. And so I want to bless you. I want to equip you, all you ladies. And so I want to invite you out on Friday nights. We are, right now for the summer, we are moving every other week. We are meeting so that you all, our summers are short in Chicago. And I wanted to bless you ladies and have you guys be able to enjoy your Friday nights with family. And so we're not meeting this Friday, but next Friday, come on out. On a Friday night at 7:30, the women, our women here are called Audacity, because we are audacious and we have the audacity to proclaim God, despite when people don't in this current culture. And so come on out on Friday nights, next Friday at 7:30, and let's start to know one another, and let's bridge those gaps of unfamiliarity and awkwardness, and let's start to love on one another. I look forward to seeing you there.
Amen. Praise God. Praise God. And along with the Facebook group announcement I made a moment ago, like the page on Facebook. We do have a Facebook page, so get ready. Like it. Leave it sitting there for a while, because it's going to be updated very, very frequently. However, we're keeping it hush-hush. Again, for the reason being is that we're resetting, we're coming together, we're dusting things off, we're building, we're growing with one another, we're learning, is this it, is this the place, is this the one, is this the people, you know, we're, in the sense of we want everybody here to know what we're about and what big things God has for us. So it's almost like get ready to hold on the roller coaster, because God is about to send us down and send us up again and then go down and go up. Hello, somebody. Roller coaster style. How many been to Great America before? Sometimes it goes scary. It gets a little scary when you're coming up and you hear the hello, somebody. And so, man, we want to see this community, this city, and the world saved. Hallelujah. Not only saved, but encouraged, discipled, just powerful, even in their cities. So for those of you that don't know, again, I want to make, first of all, I want to say hello to everybody watching online, because there are people that watch online every single week, so much so that I know for a fact when I go to Texas next month, people are going to just talk to me all about the service and be like, hey, that one time and this, that, and the other. It always happens. And so get ready, guys, because we usually always are going to have visitors from other places as well that come in, and we got to show them love and show them how Prevail Church does it. Amen? Praise God. So get excited. By the way, if you missed the past 4 weeks, the videos are on YouTube, but we do have a Prevail Church YouTube that is about to get started, Prevail Church on YouTube, but for now, it is on the YouTube.com World Renegade Church for now. Same with the money. When you give checks, it goes to the church in Westridge for now. Same thing with the YouTube videos. For now, it's on the World Renegade Church YouTube until we make that full just shift in those two areas. Amen? Does it make sense? Amen. Love you all with the love of Jesus. And I'm telling you right now, get ready for what God's going to do. And please do share amazing testimonies, as Daisy shared earlier about her being healed. Amen. So don't keep that stuff inside. If you get a promotion, if something happens and you're praying and you know God did it, can we all hear about it? Amen. That's exciting. So I love you all with the love of Jesus. I bless you all in Jesus' name. Safe travels. Until we meet again, Tuesday night is prayer night from 7:30 to 8:30. It's going to be powerful this Tuesday coming up. Bless you all. Please be safe and be disciples more than anything else of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Love you all. Go hug somebody on the way out.